Well, why are we here? We don't need to be here. This is such a wonderful morning. It's so wonderful day. You could have a million reasons. Why you're here is because we care. We care about who we are. We care about what is happening in our communities. We care about what is happening in the country. We care about what's going on around the world. And another reason we are here is because we also, I trust, want to do something about it. And that's what brings us here. So when we say that, there will be so many issues that could really be the reason for that. Well, in this case, we really want to focus on and is really the issue of renewable energy and how that is related to a number of other issues that are interconnected. And in a way, looking at the issue of renewable energy in a holistic way. And it's important because I think that when we see that things are connected, when a problem is interconnected, when we see that, it may seem overwhelming that, my God, I just thought the problem was here, but now you're saying this. On the other hand, you turn that around in a really radical perspective, radical in a good sense, that seeing the roots, that what you see, the solution also lies in different places. So it's not just the problem lies in different places. What that means is that we all, in our own ways, participate not only as victims of this problem, but also also bringer of solutions. So therefore, I think that it's important for me to look at things holistically and appreciate what I do as well as what others are doing. Okay, so energy. Okay, the question is that we have these lights here, and it's wonderful to see coming into Greenfield Community College a number of solar panels. That was inspiring. At the same time, we know that as much that's important, that's still not really the main source of our energy sources. So that is good. That's very important, critical first step, inspiring first step. But where our energy is coming from, we'll look at it, you know, broadly first. From the sun gives us the light, and it's been giving us as long as there's been life on Earth. Really. So that's the direct energy source. And then I think what happened is that years ago, some people found out, gee, there are these things called coal. Huh. Dig into them, pick them up, store them. And that was a revolutionary change in the way we use energy. What that means is that until this coal came about, we would have to wait for the sun to come out and for the sun to go down. Basically, maybe that's a part of our future, maybe better, a bigger part of our future. It still is for many, for birds and bees, maybe we need to learn from that. So there's nothing wrong with that. But that was there. But at the same time when coal came about, this was like, wow. Now you can store it, it's like a genie in a bottle. You can store it, you can tell the genie to come out when you want to, and then you can sell the genie's service. Wow, that is amazing. So, and in my mind, you know, I wasn't there then. I trust that it was a combination of perspective on it. Some people might have even then objected, really. Why are we digging up? I've read Bhagavad Gita, Song of the Earth, which says, whatever you take out of the earth, replenish it by themselves. It's 2005 years ago, they warned us that don't get in there. Make sure that whatever you take can be replenished. So wisdom has been there, okay? But point is that, really, at the same time, some people say, wow, you know, it keeps us warm, it gives us more light. I think there was good intention. And there are also people say, hey, now I can control it. I can sell it, make tons of money, and we're still doing that. So after that, coal came oil, natural gas, uranium. And I'm really especially honored that presence of Vermont Yankee. This has been part of our life's commitment also to see what we can do to move away from that path. And so these things came about. Well, here's more and more genies coming out of the bottle, and it has done a lot. But then what we're realizing is that, gee, genie is getting tired, you know, it's getting exhausted. And so something is not quite right. You know, genie doesn't live forever. And to me, that's where we are on right now. What that means is that as we have been digging up these things, right now, scientifically, general understanding is that oil, natural gas, and uranium, these three sources, we probably have anywhere between 30 to 50 years of estimated reserve. That is not just proven reserve, estimated reserve, because now we can go out in the space and photograph the Earth and send an X-ray through the Earth. We know where things are. We know what fields have been depleted. We know what is still there. We know what potentially there. As you know, that right now, Keystone, this thing is happening. We are trying to get it to more and more. We know, so all these things put together, maybe 30 to 50 years. And then coal, if we just go around maybe 200, 250 years, what does that mean? These have been depleted in the Earth for over millions of years, and we are looking at this generation and the next where these things will be depleted. That is, so what happens is that people can question about 30 to 50 to 70 to 80 years. What does that mean? Within a generation or two, we are depleting these things at, you know, at things that have been deposited for millions of years. Something is wrong with our way of looking at the Earth. Earth is our home, and we're raping and ravaging it. I use those words very seriously because that's what we do, really. That what kind of mentality does that, really? We can only, is the rapist mentality, or totally blind, that we don't really want to. We just want to have our light switched, and we don't want to see where it is coming from. So anyway, so what can we do about it? So other thing is that then what happens is that we all depend on a piece of pie. There's plenty to go around. We go to our friends, serves us, we bring in our friends, we have to share. But then we realize that pie is something we depend on, and it's getting, you know, less and less of it, and I'm getting more and more dependent of it. So I don't invite my friends anymore. I just figure out who else has that pie. Well, I go to a friend and try to buy initially from that friend. Well, the friend will sell it, but the friend realizes that, gee, that pie is scarce, and I also need it. I'm not going to give it to you. I will sell it to you. Well, I start selling it. After some time, I say, even with all the money in the world, I cannot really give this away, really. So, okay, you will not give it away. I pull out something. You know, I'll take it from you. So, in a way, question of war and energy, or war and natural resources, is an age-old one. We know that war happens for more than one reason, but that's one of the fundamental reasons and more repeated reasons why we have been at war. We are at war right now, and if you relate to, you know, if you question it, if you look into it, energy is playing a key role in energy wars that have been going on, war that has happened, and wars that are emerging. Right now, you look at Sudan. Okay, South Sudan has the oil field, so why the fight is over the oil field, really. And we are trying to build this pipeline from all the way from Afghanistan to all the way these things. And then people say, you know, for a while we are out there in Iraq trying to democratize and bring freedom to it. I would ask the question that, well, if Iraq was growing bananas instead of oil, would we have really fell for that and do all these things, spend all this money and lives, these things? Well, my answer, I thought about it, I say, yeah, we would do that if we're as dependent on bananas as we are on oil. But then we don't have to worry about that, but we have the banana republics under control. So the thing is, so we don't have to worry about that. We have to do that to get the oil republics, really. So that's been one source, that one reason, along with any other reasons, really. So to me, therefore, scarcity and war are related. Then we step away from it, really, that, all right, I will not tell you about how much we have. We have unlimited amount. That's how sometimes I hear people say, we have unlimited amount. All right. I say, what that means? Is that a solution? Well, what we know is that more we use it, we are having climate change, we are having pollutions, all these things. So in Bengali, there's a phrase, it says shakher korat, which is when it's a saw that cuts really shells. It cuts this way, it cuts that way. Okay, so it's like that, you know. It's not a solution. It cuts this way as well as cuts that way. It means having it, not having it is a problem. That's we know. Having it as well is a problem, because more we use it, it creates other problems. And all these things have social, political, economic impacts. And therefore, you have economic cost of war, economic cost of the environment, economic cost of health, economic cost of security, economic cost of products that are created using oil and other energy sources all start going up. So we know that at this point what is happening is that economies are suffering and economics are actually collapsing, industrial economies. And in future, the burden on the world of sustainability is concerned will be the industrial world. All these years we have looked at this so-called undeveloped countries as the burden, white man's burden, development burden, etc. I look at it the other way. You don't go and colonize a country because it's poor. You're such a, why are you such a fool to do that? You go there because they're so rich. But you tell them they're poor, reduce their value, and take it out and then sell, whether it is a sculptural piece or it's natural resources, okay? Things that are really worthless in those countries, artistically, sculpturally, because they're not as modern and these things. They come to museum here, they become priceless, okay? So there, all these things, natural resources are there, they come here, and that fuels our so-called advanced lifestyle. And in the meantime, they're left with a devastated environment. They cannot even afford the oil that's been taken out, natural gas, coal that's been taken out. Anyway, so that's a whole another thing to just say at this point to go more from here, is to say the how these things are interrelated. And I say that because I'm part of it. I'm not telling you, I'm telling I'm part of it. We have to look at these things together. It's not us versus them. It's a very small world. That's really a beautiful world, really. But at the same time, it's a world that we share and we have to work together. And all of it is not you versus me or us versus them. It's all of us together at it. Okay. So I have thought about all these things, and almost 30 years ago when people were going into Vietnam, and I started thinking that, my God, why are we going there? And then I was noticing that, you know, while the Vietnam was closing, because we were protesting, we were undergraduate students at Northeastern, we see a lot of military deployment going on in Middle East, in Colombia, and this thing. I said, hey, hold on, are we really finishing the war, ending the war, or war is shifting? And why are we shifting the war? What are on those countries? So in my mind, just naive thinking, really, I started putting the two together. For me, right or wrong, is that oil is a reason that why this war is building up, really, all these things. So then what happened, I was just, as I say, young student, and I was heading up an international student organization. So I organized a forum called Middle East, the next Vietnam. That was a question. That was 1968. And unfortunately, unfortunately, I wasn't wrong. I wish I was wrong, but I wasn't. But at the same time, not being wrong gave me a reason to work on what's right. So that became my question. All right, where do I go from here? Well, if energy is a reason we have to go to war, and energy is we need, what can we do, what kind of energy we can get so that we don't have to go to war? So I started thinking about it. And I look at the sun while it's there, I say, well, that's not enough, really, because we use it in technological ways. So I started learning, teaching myself about this solar cells. First time I met, I acquired a little solar cell years ago. That was my prize, really. This thing. So in a way, a lot has happened since then, and it's exciting. Okay, so what happened is that since then, I've been asking myself that question. And now I will just once again just say that that's what I want to talk to you about, really. I would not have to talk to you about all those things you know more than I do. You have been part of the experience, the movement, and you're part of this movement also right now, but share with you, really, what can we do about it? If the energy is, if we are having this energy crisis, and a crisis that's related to political crisis, economic crisis, environmental crisis, well, what can we do about it? Okay, what can we do about it? So we have to look at things fundamentally. It's useful to look at things fundamentally. Look at the sun. Sun gives us light, it's been giving us heat, wind, water movement. All these things are a result of sun for millions and millions of years. And will continue to do that. I says, oil, natural gas, coal, uranium, they're between anywhere between 30 years to 250 years. All of these things together. Sun will not last forever either. I sit down, I think about it, my God, when will the sun, how long the sun is going to be? Well, the understanding I have is you know, at least 250 billion, people really do not know. So that's given me a little more hope. I think that we have a little more time to think, and maybe we'll continue to, if we're sensible, if we're organically growing, we will evolve with that. So, but on the other hand, if we go against it, Well, species have been extinct, really. So to me, when people say, well, we're damaging the earth, ruining the earth, there's true that too. But that's also this sort of like a Western arrogance that, you know, we have the power to control and conquer the nature. We're not. Earth and nature is far stronger. We don't end nature. Nature is, has been there. Nature will continue. And Bill McKibben is a very good friend of mine. I have a lot of admiration for his work. But to me, at the same time, I don't hesitate saying that, that sometimes the attitude is that we are ending nature or we are hurting nature. We are doing away to the earth. Earth is very intelligent, very powerful. Earth has, over the years, tested species, given that a chance. You're not living in congruent in harmony with the earth, you're out, really. So I worry about that human species may be extinct before the earth is more damaged, really. And it is getting damaged, but I think at the same time, a lot to be said for also being respectful to the earth and trying to heal what is there. So, so in this case, we're not this or that. So if that is so, let's just take things from there. So sun gives us direct light, and it has the way I see, look at it, subsystems: light, heat, wind, water movement, and photosynthesis. These are five subsystems through which we get energy from the sun. And so those are renewable energy sources. And from there on, we look at how renewable energy sources to renewable technologies. So what we're going to do here is look at some technologies that are connected to these renewable energy sources. And I will tell you a few brief words about it. But I think what's much more exciting is to be able to just see some, right, what I brought here. And if when you go out, unless you have seen it and you already work with it, you've seen some of the photovoltaics installed outside. And then from there on, that okay, here it is, from here, this table to the Greenfield Community College campus, to what's happening around the world. And to me, that is so exciting, because I have seen that how something can take off. Really, people have that commitment, concern, and wisdom, because people are smart if they're given a chance. And I have a lot of appreciation for that, because seeing that happen. So what we'll do there, we'll take a quick survey of some of the applications around the world. And then after that, as I said, that I'm not here just to tell you and show you what I have, but also to engage in a dialogue. So you share with with me and each other your experience and what we can learn from each other. That sounds fine? Okay, so we'll go with that. So to go here first is, I'll start with a very simple thing here. It's really one side of a refrigerator cardboard cut off and folded like that. And then I have here is a bag that's Renewable over bag. It doesn't melt under 350 degree Fahrenheit. You can buy them in supermarkets, whether it's Whole Foods, Stop and Shop, any other. Okay, you put this in there. Put the pot in there. And cover it up. And you have a little tie here. So. Okay, voila. You have this here, you put it out in the sun for 2 good hours. You'll get about close to 275 to 300 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, so it's like an oven, really. The way it works is light comes and these things really reflect the light to the pot, and pot is black. It could be any other this thing, but this is a better, hold the heat better. And it's inside the plastic bag, and it's sitting inside, the heat can flow. So you put it down, and what will happen is that, what is the simple physics? Light carries heat, but it can be trapped. Heat can be trapped, okay? So it starts building up. And within 2 hours of good sunlight, well, you can really have a solar oven that's giving you 275, 300 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you put food in there, for depending on whatever you're cooking, some people say, what can you cook? You can cook practically anything. It will just you know, you divide up the time. Rice, for example, will cook in an hour. Vegetables, half an hour, 45 minutes. You can cook fish, meat, if you eat meat, you know, it will take that much more time. Basically, it's a solar oven. So this is just one example of a very simple device, and we'll look at some other ones that can be homemade, and I've done a number of them, and also different examples that you can that you can use. Okay, going to the, if you call it technology that is more technologically developed, if you say call it that, or high tech, photovoltaics. What is photovoltaic? Is if you take sand, it shines, you know, the shiny things, those are, what they do is that they generate electricity. Okay, silicon generates electricity. You bring it to the lab, you grow it like a, you know, whether it's cucumber, and then you slice it, and you put cells together next to each other, shape it, and then you have a positive and negative, so the electricity can flow. So basically the physical property is that silicon generates electricity, and you grow it, and then you make cells. It's going to be that kind, or it can be put several ones here, like here. If I, here's a cell, it's a 15 watt cell, and if I put it out in the sun and turn this light on, the light would come on. But it's a, and it can be therefore small or big, and the cells can be shaped in different ways. Okay, and then other one here is that if you look at a, and now this is not working. Why? Because, well, it could work if it went outside. It's not because there's not enough sun. Well, but people say that I need light at night or when it is dark. What do we do? For that, there's another system. This is a solar system. Okay. What this is doing is right now is doing the same thing. It generates electricity, but you have, instead of, and these are the bulbs, but these bulbs are, instead of connecting to the panel, it's going connected to the battery. So from here, it's coming into the battery. From battery to going to, so when you turn that on, you have two lights. So what happened is that this is connecting both these devices, electricity generating, it's generating electricity, it's sending it to the battery, and I can use this battery, energy stored in the battery anytime we want. And to me, it is, of course, theoretically possible, we know practically possible, and my most recent experience is, some of you may know, Boston had, about 3 weeks ago, had a power failure in Boston. Inverter exploded, half the Boston was dark for close to three days, 24 hours. And it was quite amazing. We live in the middle of Boston next to the Museum of Fine Arts. Schools, colleges, hospitals, really, they had that emergency. Some of them had the emergency light, but that's very little because, but most of the building was pitch dark. We live in 140 in the Fenway, which is a fifth floor condominium building, and we lived on the fifth floor, unit 16. You look at this building, the only building, only light that is coming through that building is our unit, really. And so we had no problem because we were using this, that, and we have an installed solar system, which is a 45 watt system, sitting outside the windows in 1986, powering our three lights. We have powers our cell phone charger, you know, our, we can run a laptop and computer if you plug it in. We have some small fans. So we have all these things since 1986. So nobody has to convince me about the reliability of it, really. So that was, people were interviewing the system rather than me, really. The editor from the local paper called me right away, really, that your light was this thing. Can you write something about it? Of course, I've written this thing, I did. And so that's good news, really, that there are solutions to problems we face expectedly or unexpectedly. Okay. So now I've shared with you some of these systems, which I would like to go back, or I go right now, is to look at some of the applications of this thing in a wider, larger global scale. Okay, sun, renewable energy sources, light, wind, heat, water movement, and photosynthesis. These are the renewable energy sources. And so from renewable sources, we have some of these technologies. Corresponding examples are photovoltaics, wind generator for electricity, solar thermal system for hot water and other purposes, hydroelectric system for electricity, and solar cookers. There are different kind of solar cookers, and you saw one of them, and we'll look at some others as well. So from renewable energy sources to renewable energy technologies. Okay, so let's look at some of this example. Here's a wind PV hybrid power charging station. There's wind and there's PV. That's in Nicaragua. It's one of my students really has pretty much moved there, and this has been one of his work of love. Okay, as we drive interstate the Southeast Expressway, there you have a wind turbine. That's larger one, as you see, so it can be different sizes. Okay, and there's also PV here, right here. Okay, Hull Wind, that was 660 kilowatt installed in 2001, and it generates about enough energy for about 500 homes, but that was more conventional bulbs and other things. But so, of course, efficiency and renewables and conservation can go hand in hand. So if efficient bulbs are put in, it will triple, and LED will even triple, even more than that. Okay, so they have put in another one, 1.8 megawatt, installed in 2006. Okay, a question always comes up, is that all right? I mean, do we have enough space? Well, I think that what is becoming more of a practice around the world is that you can use the same space for multiple purposes. And here you have this Germany, it's growing energy as well as food. So you grow two things. Okay, you can have those are onshore, you can have offshore. This is wind farm in Denmark. You can see it's going to be quite architecturally, aesthetically present. Okay, and then this is Bahrain World Trade Center. Those are tall, two tall buildings. And if you are building two tall buildings, usually wind flows pretty rapidly, more like a tunnel. So these are really big. These are about 10 to 12 feet high. People go from one building to another. And so what they have done is they put wind turbines there. So it's generating wind as well, generating electricity as well. Okay, Logan Airport has put wind turbines. And it's one of his buildings, and you can see that it's really not very tall because they have taken a tall building to really install them. So it's about 6-7 feet high, and it's getting the wind. And this is a new generation that's coming up. It's like it spins, and if you can order it, and so that you want to put a picture of your a dog or a picture of a flower that you like, and you know, a picture of your parents, grandpa, anybody that your literary figure, well, they will do that, really. So you can have your custom design in that sense, in terms of the look of it. And this is really quite efficient, and I've seen some of them work very well. Okay, we go to some solar cooker. This is in Nicaragua, Grupo Phoenix. This is the Solar Women of Totogalpa. You can see this is a box cooker. What is here is that there's a glass here, light goes in, and heats up, and you open the box and you put the take the food out. You put the food in the same way. Okay, this is the solar cooker in Armenia. There I'm standing, and I was invited to look at the energy situation there after the Soviet collapse, and of course it was very much of the world that we are moving toward, because all these buildings really were suffering. So I was there, it was an honor, and these are my team members. He's the chief scientific person in the country, and professor, deputy minister of engineer, professor, that's great. I invited their children to be part of it. So they were initially surprised that why are we talking about children when this is a national crisis? Well, I can understand that, but I said, well, it's their future. If they start participating in solution right from now, maybe, you know, their future will be different. So they agreed, and so here they are, all these children are their children, and so it was great. That's the first solar cooker made in Armenia in 1994. Okay, dish type solar concentrator, basically what it beams heat under this pot. That's about 600 degrees, so it's like instant match. If you just put a paper or a stick, it will catch fire like a matchstick. Okay, this is you can see, this is on a roof deck. We live on the fifth floor, so we just have to go one step up to go to our roof deck, and that's Prudential building right behind us. Okay, this is a solar box cooker, which is really will work only when it is sunny, and that's great. I mean, we use a lot of that. We can use that. And this one will do the same thing. This tulsi is made in India, and but it's available right now here. It will do the same thing. You put it out in the sun, but this will all this can also be connected to a power line to get work like an electric oven. So what we have is that since we have a solar electric system, we have an inverter, and so we connect it to our solar electric system. So we can do solar cooking day, night, rain or shine, anytime. So, okay, this is a little simple like that. It's cut from a television box, and you can see that it's really actually cooking. Okay, solar greenhouse, this is Martha's Vineyard. My friend Anna Edie, she built that, and this since 1983. It produced a lot of organic food inside, and she became rightfully very well known both here and around the world. And so her focus now has been to create this small scale, home scale greenhouses, solar greenhouses. Okay, this is Natick Organic Farm in Natick. You can see that's about a 10 kilowatt system and solar greenhouse. Okay, this is inside, and normally they would have to wait to do this until the season, you know, it was further in the spring, but they're able to do this right now because it's solar greenhouse. Okay, and you can just see this is in India, in the Ladakh district in the Himalayas. Just note that it's outside this is minus 25 degrees centigrade, so cold, and inside it's greenhouse like this. Okay, this is also another design. This can be the organization that are doing it. RT has also designed some that are portable. It can be like in city, you can put it in your porch, really. And basically what they're aiming for is that a family, a city family, whatever the vegetable scraps they they have, that how much gas can, cooking gas that can generate. And they're trying to really bring the efficiency to a point, try to match a family of four will have cooking gas on a pretty much in a daily way using a solar cooker like this. Okay, this is a biogas cooking for and lighting in Bangladesh. You can see this cooking right here and lighting there. Okay, this is in Nicaragua. It's next to the actually outhouse, and we are pretty resourceful in many ways. So whatever is discharged from humans go into that and generates cooking gas. Okay, and it can be huge size too. Like you can see, this is in Canada. It's 1 megawatt electrical production. Along with that, it's high-grade fertilizer, fish feed, other things. So it's really very, very useful. Okay, now we come to some solar hot water systems, which is right here. That's really Greg, Rich, and Margaret standing in front of the house. This is in Jamaica Plain, and this is one of the pioneering installations, and that's been providing them with almost 100% of the solar hot water during the summer and about 50% during the winter. Okay, solar hot water, PV, solar box cooker. Solar hot water, PV, and solar box, 100% renewable energy powered home in Lesotho, Africa. Okay, solar hot water system in Parthenon, Greece. You can see the Parthenon. Okay, solar hot water system in Lebanon. Solar hot water systems in the Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. Our son Ashok was doing a semester abroad there, and then here we are waiting for his picture. Since the first picture he sends us is this, Dad, there's a solar hot water system on our roof. So that's great. Okay, in China. Okay, this is Fenway Park. It provides about one third of the water the Fenway Park uses. I bet it used a lot yesterday. Okay, micro hydro, and again, this is where question comes is that no matter renewable or non-renewable, we have to look at things holistically. Hydro is renewable, but at the same time, we know that large hydros can be devastating for environment. But that technology is very valid in the sense that it is can be done in scale, so that will not interfere. You can see the wilderness is still there, and is generating electricity for whole lot of families and businesses in the community. Or look at this one in Kenya. This is just stream coming down, and there's a micro hydro there. It's providing electricity for the entire region there. Okay, now we come to photovoltaics. which is direct conversion of sunlight into electricity. All right. You know, the idea is not new. Shakespeare said it too. Sun, it shines everywhere. Okay, and then people are continually trying to figure out how much of it we have and what is the potential. Okay, so this is by Daniel Nocera, which is an MIT professor, and he says that only 1 hour of sunlight falling on the Earth's surface contains energy equivalent to what we use globally for an entire year. What that means is the potential is so huge, we have not even scratched really this thing. And then we don't have to convert the whole thing. We don't need 1,000 times more than what we use. We need what we use. And then this is just talking about light, really. You have other sources as well. So you can see the solution is there right now, well proven. We just have to get into that. And okay, solar cell manufacturing, sand, polysilicon, single crystal ingot, wafers, as you saw, a cell, and a solar module, which is this here. Okay, well, again, it's one of the world's most tested technologies, because when world's first solar power satellite was sent in 1964, look at this, 58, actually, look at this. These are solar cells. It would be a long pipeline to send power that, really. And even the voice silence in 1964 and still orbiting, it's continuing to, solar cells are still there. Okay, Mir space station. Okay, Solar Challenger on July 7, 1980, crossing the English Channel. And these are solar panels. And I asked that question, well, what happens when the sun goes down or sun is covered by sun? So when I speak to the young kids, especially at like junior high, he said, you have to find water to jump, really. So they come up with all this thing. And then one of them said, did you say there was a battery? So they come up with, I listened to them. Yeah, so that's it. You know, it's a good thing that there's water too, really, but also really there's a battery in there, so it continues to fly. And this is a real picture of the International Space Station. Okay, now we come to some solar, from celestial use to terrestrial use, Earth. Okay, solar panel. Generate electricity going into the battery like it went here, and from there on it's connected. It's a charge controller which controls electricity from overcharging the battery or from electricity flowing back into the panel at night. And then from there it also tells you how much I have, and so I can use it for, depending on the capacity, whatever I want to use it for, light, fans, you know, refrigerator, anything you like. It's, the system has to be sized accordingly. Okay, Sri Lanka. There's a little panel here, powers three lights, a television point, and a cell phone charger. So that's enough for that family. Worthington, Massachusetts, we are standing right here. We are standing in front of it. And that's Jeffrey Fowler's home. He powered the whole home. There was, at that time in 1986, there was no power line within 3 miles of the house, really. He powered his entire house from those panels. Okay, this is in El Salvador. Here I am. This is the person who is a bricklayer. That's Rodrigo Contreras, his house. He offered to really his place to install this system as a pilot system for the community. So here I am, and this is my former student from Brandeis. I just took Doug as a team. So here we are installing it, and this is how it looks. Okay, you can see that these are carrying medicine. These two small refrigerators and smart camel. Okay, this is a operating room. Okay, Saudi Arabia, this desalination which takes salt water and turns into sweet water, and lighting. Okay, little panel here for the telephone. This is in Bangladesh, the solar panel here, solar cooker here, biogas at the back. It's 100% renewable energy home. And I did it personally, so I know that things work. And this is a very typical model for millions and millions of homes around the world. There's a little school way up and in a very rural area in Bangladesh that was named after my mother, so they invited me to visit the school. I said, well, that was, of course, a special honor to see that. And as part of my gift to them, we gave them a solar system. So So here's the solar system. So not only there's, now their school has these three lights here, here, and in this building. So now it can also work as an adult literacy center and a community center at night, as well as, of course, school during the day. It's a actually island in Bangladesh. You can see all these things are powered by solar. Okay, this is Bangladesh Bank. Here I'm standing with the governor of Bangladesh. And I introduced photovoltaics in Bangladesh in 1986. And since then, it has really, I mean, not only through the projects I helped, and I still am involved with this thing, there are a lot of other initiatives, and it has become actually leading user of renewables in the world. And that's a good news, along with other news that we get, and we have to pay attention to that too. So here, the governor was very proud to take me up and show this, and they said, this is your contribution. I said, no, this is not my contribution, it's your contribution, and it's all of our contribution. So that's great. And this is the bank building, and there's a huge banner here, Solar Power Bangladesh. And he has also introduced financing through the bank at 5% interest rate annual for solar power. So not only that he uses, he has really been an instrumental getting solar power for Bangladesh Bank, and it's almost like a 500 branches throughout the country, but it also has a very, really, very useful financing mechanism, because the cost is really, people know over time, is, you know, cost effective, but upfront payment is a challenge. So he has really introduced that. And so this is, Bangladesh is filled with rivers, and so this is a solar power school they bought in Bangladesh. You can see solar power, but this is during daytime, and it's a pretty nice day, so they're sitting and, you know, studying outside there. But inside there, it can be, there's lights in there, there's a library, there are computers, all of these things are there, and the boat can move around to different places. This is a boat that traveled from all the way from, you can see, Spain in November 2006, 7,000 mile journey, arriving in New York in 2007, May 8, 2007. One of our friend, Martin, is really, there's I think six Swiss people there. And Martin is, he's a physician, but he's not committed to really absolutely work on this issue. He's one of them. And I was giving a talk at the University of Maine, so this person came and to listen, and then after I said, can I show you something that I do? Well, here is, really. He did that, and it's so inspiring to me. And I think he has a thing called, his license plate says, Look Ma, no gas. okay, this is, all right. Solar car came all the way from Florida. So you can see out here, or it can be a solar charging station. This is the University of South Florida. Okay. Horses are still renewable though. Okay, so you probably have seen this. You know, it's a silently has revolutionized street signs, really, because it doesn't make any noise. Silently, because in the past it would be a generator or a power line coming from half a mile away or from this thing. Silently, meaning people sometimes don't even know that how that is being working, because the solar panel and there's a computer there. You can write anything you want, and that's what does it. Okay, solar module supplies, water delivery. This is the one, and this is a conventional one. That's Richard Hansen. He's actually founder and president of Solus, which is formerly Enersol. He's also a pioneer. Okay, Cuba is one of the really best kept secrets here. Cuba has now taken a plan to really go 100% renewable as soon as possible, and they're taking schools, homes, hospitals, and really going as much as they can do to raise their clinic. And also organic agriculture. As you know that in when the Soviet collapsed, Cuba used to have about 80% chemical agriculture, 20% organic. And now in Havana, city of Havana, 50% of the food grown in Havana is organically grown. And around the country, they're almost reaching 80% of the food organically grown. They've switched because they went through the time that no, will not try to, you know, get oil from other thing to keep our agriculture going. They went through this special period to make that transition. That's quite inspiring, and renewable energy as well. Okay, this is Richard Kamm. Some of you may know this thing. He lives in Maine, and he's a pioneer. Right there he is, and these other two are also longtime activists. This is Richard's home. When I went to work, give a talk at the University of Orono in Maine, I stayed with him, longtime friend of ours. This has been a house that he built in 1988, and it's 100% renewable energy home. Okay, this is in 47 watt standalone PV system, 140 in the Fenway. That's been there since 1986, as I mentioned. It powers, you know, three lights, table fan, record player, digital camera batteries, cell phone, and our Tulsi hybrid solar cooker. And then, this is our house. There you are. I think Hitchcock would have liked to use this. And inside. Okay, now we go to grid connected, which means that there's, you see, no battery connected to the grid. Okay, so it's just basically the grid stores the battery, stores the electricity, and you're essentially sending it, so the meter tells you, so you get that credit, and depending on the policy, you have that, really, whether you get money back or you credit back, that's depending on the policy. Okay. Gardner, not too far from here, is one of the pioneering installations in the country, in the world, really, 1985. There are 30 homes, town hall, library, community college, furniture outlet, Burger King, implemented in 1985. They're still working, and I've been there. I brought many of my friends and my students there. Go a little fast so we can have the time for conversation, but we can always come back in our discussion to any of this. Town hall, Burger King. Okay, main solar home of Bill and Debbie Lord, PV and hot water system. People say, can you use this thing in city? Well, look at this, 4 Times Square Manhattan. No city is more city than New York. No place is more central in a city than Times Square. And no number is more central in city central is number 4, Times Square. So this is what it is. All these 4 sides are solar panels, and they're transparent solar panels, so they're like window, and it generates electricity, and it is put on north, south, east, west. The person was asked that, why are you putting on, you know, other sides? Really, he said, well, of course, we know that you put facing south or facing the sun, you get most, but time is coming where any source of light will be using. Don't do that, and I want to put my money where my value is, and so that's what they built. And I've been there, and it looks like any other building, like this. But it's all solar powered. Again, a percentage of the building, and they also have fuel cell at the bottom. So, okay. Train station in Long Island, okay, Swiss ingenuity. It's a sound barrier, so the sound from these cars don't go into the community. At the same time, generates electricity for the community. Germany, right there, that's our friend's house is right here. This is a friend's neighbor. And this house needs this much. And they put the whole thing, because Germany has a policy that if you generate electricity, we'll fund it with huge subsidies. And then when you sell it, we'll pay you more than what you'd be buying from conventional electricity. So people are looking at the roofs and say, hey, I could, you know, earn some income from it. And Germany's policy right now is to 2050 to go 100% renewable. That's the most progressive policy right now. And 100% renewable by 2050. PV, wind, and biomass. These are the 3 main sources. Okay, this is Bavaria Solar Park. Okay, this is much space taken, but you can see, you can graze under it, or you can grow food under it. This community, energy surplus, because it grows more, it generates more electricity than it uses, the community uses, so it sells electricity. So that's one of the incomes. Multi-story building in Germany. Okay, and fuel cell are being now generated through using PV, solar, or it could be wind as well, because fuel cell is another potential, solar hydrogen, but it takes a lot of energy to produce that, and that was really not really being very helpful, but right now using PV or wind or other renewable sources, it's becoming very very, you know, cost effective. Okay, this is Bedsett, Beddington, zero fossil energy department. This is London. People think about London as London fog. And these people say that, hey, London fog can be also renewable. So there you are. I was just walking down the street one day, it's in Worthing, Massachusetts, about 3 years ago, about, and looked at this house. Okay, Mark, okay, India. Okay, this is the largest photovoltaic station, 60 megawatt in Spain. There are larger ones are under construction. This is a street light, night light, a combination of things. This is our Napa wine. They want to use the land they have for growing wine, so they put this in the water, floating, photovoltaics. Japan has now really making a very, very concerted effort to turn into, and this was happening before Fukushima, but then it just was really, the nuclear power is very strong there, and there you have your tremendous work to cut out there as well, really. But now they're really trying to come back. Anyway, so these are our, interesting thing is that this is generating electricity for the factory there, and the person who was head of it was a woman, and she was actually fired or honorably discharged because this is before Fukushima, because it was really not the way she should be making a judgment, really, executive decisions. Now she's a folk hero, rightfully. Okay, this is a cemetery in Spain. People whose relatives are there, they got together, they said, well, our, you know, they are not doing very much, sleeping all day and all night. They could still do something for the future. So they put, they allowed their graveyard to be thing there. Okay, that's Vatican Solar. Okay, this is under construction, Master Carbon Free City in Abu Dhabi. They are aware that things are coming to an end, oil-based economy. All right, Boston Nature Center. Back of it, Foster Nature Center. This is a Kapuanamba Childhood Center, Early Childhood Center. And this is National Grid Solar Power Station. If you go through it's right outskirts of Boston. Okay, Solar Peace Fountain. There's Rohan and Juliana. This one powers it, and this is a solar fountain. Okay, Solar Shopping Center. And this is there, it's our friend's house, Henry and Juliana and Liz. And I'm not doing it, I'm just learning how they do it, right there. And this is how it is. There, Henry, Juliana, and Liz standing in front of their house, solar slates. That's it. Okay, so Boston Arts Academy, there we are, install that. Okay, this is a Fenwick Views Community Affordable Housing Building, condominium. Okay, that's where it is. Okay, school. This is one of the first ones, Georgetown University, Northeastern University. This is Lewis Environmental Studies Center in Oberlin, Tufts, Brandeis, Harvard Science Center. And just a couple of quotes to end with. We are like tenant farmers chopping down the fence around our house for fuel when we should be using nature's inexhaustible source of energy, sun, wind, and tide. I'd put my money on the sun and solar energy. What a source of power. I hope we don't have to wait until oil and coal run out before we tackle that. Thomas Alva Edison said it in, okay, considered father of the electrical age. Okay, most recent report. By 2050, we could get all the energy we need from renewable sources. This report shows that such a transaction is not only possible, but also cost-effective, providing energy that is affordable for all and producing it in ways that can be sustained by the global economy and the planet. The energy report, 100% renewable energy by 2050. World Wildlife Fund 2011. And the last slide is that you never change something by fighting the existing reality. To change something, build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete. So to me, my approach to that is, of course, we have to fight what, you know, encroaches, and because sometimes the destruction takes place faster than new things coming in, so we have to keep fighting that. But at the same time, fighting, sometimes just protesting and fighting has to be combined with also what we want, really. And that's what we are here for, and that's what we're doing. So thank you very much, and now it's for me to listen and engage in dialogue. Thank you.